God is good, amen? All right, let's begin reading Romans 13 and starting at verse 1, Romans 13, 1, Paul says, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes. For the authorities are ministers of God attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them. Taxes to whom taxes are owed. Revenue to whom revenue is owed. Respect to whom respect is owed. Honor to whom honor is owed." Today we're going to talk about this question. What do Christians believe about government? What do Christians believe about government? Let's pray together. Let's invite the Holy Spirit to help us as we look into his word today. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in the beautiful name of your Son, Jesus, that we've been magnifying here today. And we thank you for the gift of your word. Jesus said that the word of God is like seed. So, Father, we ask you to touch our hearts in these next minutes, Lord. Would you let our hearts be good soil that can receive and hold on to and bear fruit from the seed of the word of God? Lord Jesus, you said that the words you speak to us are spirit and they are life. So please send your spirit now and minister life to us out of the word. If you agree with that, would you say amen and amen? Well, over the last few weeks, we've been talking about what it means to have a transformed Christian mind. We've seen that if we want to discover God's will and do it, we need to experience what we've been calling a mental metamorphosis. We need a radical change in how we think. In Romans 12:2, Paul says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." In order to do the will of God, we must think differently than unbelievers. Our values must be different from theirs. Our thinking needs to reflect the mindset and the values of the kingdom, not the values of this world. We began our series seeing how a transformed mind starts with a transformed heart. Pastor Glenn shared with us that the problem with our head is actually our heart. And we need a heart that's been transformed by Christ. And that in turn leads to a Christ-transformed mind. Our minds will be transformed as we feed on the Word of God. And we said that the Bible is the principal tool that God uses both to cleanse our minds and then to change our thinking. More recently, we shared what Christians believe about the Bible and about God and about creation and history. Last week, Pastor Glenn shared with us how we should think about love, the sincere love that comes from God that causes us to be devoted one to another as brothers and sisters in Christ. And that love is characterized by giving us a fiery devotion to God. If you missed that message, make sure you do yourself a favor, get a copy of that CD, or you can just jump onto our website and listen to it. And today we're going to explore what Christians believe about another vital topic. We're going to explore what Christians believe about government. Everybody has an opinion about government, you know, especially as we start creeping closer to April 15th, amen? Young people may not know him, but Will Rogers was an actor and a comedian who became one of America's first movie stars. And Will Rogers is the guy who famously said, "I never met a man I didn't like." And despite his down-home cheerfulness, Rogers was a clever cynic on the topic of government. Many of his political one-liners were the stuff of legend. And I just wanted to share with you this morning a couple of things that Will Rogers said about government. Will Rogers said, "The man with the best job in the country is the vice president. All he has to do is get up every morning and say, "How's the president?" Will Rogers said, "I don't make jokes. I just watch the government and report the facts." Will Rogers said, "Alexander Hamilton started the U.S. Treasury with nothing, and that's the closest we've ever come to being even." And last but not least, as we move towards April 15th, Will Rogers said, "The only difference between death and taxes is that death doesn't get worse every time Congress meets." Well, we can laugh with Will Rogers, but if we're going to think and live Christianly, we need to understand government from God's perspective. And we're people called to be lights in the world. And so as believers, our understanding of government is tremendously important, as Paul explains. Here, as everywhere else, our thinking needs to be shaped by the Word of God. And in our scripture reading today, Paul is giving us the section, the largest section of scripture, actually, that teaches us about government specifically. And so he's giving us a miniature treatise on government from God's point of view. And I want to share with you three great truths about government from Romans 13, and may the Lord give us his grace. My message today is not about politics, so go ahead and breathe a sigh of relief if you like. You may want to turn to your neighbor and say, "I'm so thankful." Amen. But politics is about the process of governing and policies, and that is a fruitful discussion for Christian people to have, of course, but not without the foundation of talking about government itself. So without any politics today, let's see what God says about government and the responsibilities that you and I have concerning government. So three great truths about government from Romans 13. And the first one is this: government is a God thing. Government is a God thing. Paul says in Romans 13, 1 and 2, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God." Paul teaches us here that government is God's authority being extended into the world. It's a God thing. First, let's understand that God himself is the highest authority. And only God has authority within himself. So there is no authority except what comes from God. Pastor Glenn shared with us not long ago that this is because God only is sovereign. While power may be the ability to do or perform something, authority is the right to do something. And you know, church, unlike every other living being, only the uncreated God can do whatever he wishes. More than six of you ought to say amen there. Praise God. The psalmist said, "Our God is in heaven. He does whatever he pleases." And he's the only one about which that may be said. Jesus said, "Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Only God has inherent authority. And every lesser authority ultimately derives its authority from him and responds to him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, whether they recognize him openly or not. Now, God may delegate some bit of his authority to others, but we know as believers that he really only shares his authority with one. We know, don't we, that because of the humility and the obedience of Christ, the Bible says that God also has highly exalted him and given him that name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. What a powerful name it is. Jesus said, "All authority has been given to me, both in heaven and in earth." So God is the highest authority. God is also the one who instituted government. Paul says the authorities that exist, he says, have been instituted by God. And therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. And that word appointed, in Greek, it means that the structure of the universe is something that God arranged. It's his arrangement, in other words. It's how he ordered things. And I share this with you recently, how the Bible shows us the history of God's dealings with man. Part of this was God setting up different types of government over time. You know, when Adam and Eve were in the garden, there was no government. Once Adam fell, even then God simply allowed humanity to be governed by our own consciences. That ended in disaster. Genesis chapter 6 tells us, "The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." So God judged that world by a flood, but you know what, church? It's still true today that wherever there is no real government, there is always chaos and there is suffering. After the flood, God did institute governments for the first time. In Genesis 9, God said, "Whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed, for in the image of God he made man." So the very beginning of human government was God commanding people to punish crime, and that would preserve some level of public safety. Now, most of you will know that after God brought the Israelites out of Egypt, he gave them a very detailed code of laws. The law of Moses not only governed worship, but it also governed what you could eat and family structures and property rights and crime and all kinds of things. It was designed by God to build a model society that would be a light to the nations. And behind all of that was the understanding that these laws came from God's divine authority. Church, you know, in Moses' law, when God commanded his people to live holy, God did not say, "Do this because it's good for you." Or he wouldn't say, "Do this because it's the right thing to do." Instead, over 50 times in the law, he said, "Do this, I am the Lord." That's a different matter. Of course, what he was commanding them was wise and good, but behind all of it was his personal authority saying, "I am God and I have the right to command. I am the fountain of all authority." Final thing we need to see here is that government represents God's authority in human society in just the same way as God has set up authorities in other spheres of life. So in order to establish his authority everywhere in human society, God has delegated authorities in different areas of life. We can't go into detail on it today, but the Bible shows us how God has appointed different authorities in the family and in the church and so on. Now, when it comes to governments, we understand from Scripture that God is the one who causes kings to rise and to fall. Whether it was in his own nation of Israel or whether it was among the Gentiles, it's God who sets up rulers and determines the limits of their power. As we said when we spoke about history, God is managing the course of the nations over time. And so kings and presidents and prime ministers, they are God's instruments for the good of a society, or so he would have them to be. We read in Daniel that God is the one who changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and he raises up others. It says, "The Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms on earth and he gives them to anyone he wishes." God raised up some kings like Cyrus to be a blessing to his people. Others like Nebuchadnezzar, he raised them up to be instruments of judgment. Doesn't mean that what these men did was all good or all bad. But God was installing whom he desired. And if we take Romans 13 at face value, he continues to do so. Church, in other words, God allows presidents you like to be in office, and God allows presidents you don't like to be in office. Government represents God's authority in human society taken as a whole. It was his idea, and he's the source of all authority. So the first great truth about government is that it's a God thing. The second truth about government is this: government is a good thing. Government is a good thing. One way to look at government is to see it, as I said, as God's authority extended into the world. Another way to see it is to see it as God's influence working in the people of the world. Some of us are tempted at times to see government as evil. But you know, Scripture views government as a good thing. Now, I know as Christians, we are taught not to love this present world or this present age because this age stands in opposition to Christ. And yet, church, I want you to grasp this today. Human government is not the same thing as what the Bible calls the world. Government is not evil per se. Government serves good purposes in the plan of God. Paul says at verse 3, rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who's in authority? Then do what is good and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. He is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. So Paul says bluntly there that the ruler is God's servant. Just as, let's say, elders are God's servants in the church, Paul uses the very same word in Greek to call rulers God's servants in society. It's the word diakonos, where we get the word deacon from. So whether government officials realize it or not, they are God's servants and they execute his purposes. So in this sense, President Trump is the servant of God. Governor Cuomo and Governor Malloy are the servants of God also. Now see, I just made the whole room unhappy in one shot. And that's not easy to do, amen? How many of you are glad you're not me this morning? You know, you say, I wonder what it'd be like to be a pastor. Well, you're glad you're not me today. Praise the Lord. Listen, church, seriously, county and city officials are servants of God. Not because they're believers, although some of them are. Not because they're walking in a holy lifestyle, although some of them may be. They are servants of God because they occupy a position in which God is seeking to use them to bring about his will. Why did God institute human governments? Paul tells us. First, because God wishes to restrain evil in human society. How many of you know that God, our God, is a God of love and a God of justice? He desires people to be safe, to be secure, to have good, happy lives, and to experience wholeness. That's his heart. God says, I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life so that both you and your seed after you may live. But we know, don't we, that nevertheless, the human race has chosen life far too infrequently. And in our fallen world, as we know, people suffer not only from accidents, but often by the deliberate acts of others. And I know many of you have been touched by human evil. There are sadly few of us who have not been touched, or our families have not been touched at some point along the way by human evil. And this is the first reason that God arranged governments. Paul said, rulers are a terror to bad conduct. In other words, some people will simply not conform their lives to a wholesome standard of behavior unless there is some external threat that is hanging over them. Now, that's an unpleasant truth, but it's a truth. Some people have the fear of God. Others do live righteously because they are indeed born again people, regenerated by the Spirit of God, and they seek to follow the ways of God. But some people, unfortunately, have no fear of God. And they might seek to get away with many things, even hurtful things, if they could. And for some people, it is only the fear of consequences that will deter them from evil. Paul says it is God who has instituted the idea of having rulers to be a terror to bad conduct. And so it is that every society, anywhere you go around the globe, has criminal laws. The making of laws and police forces, the likelihood of punishment, these things serve God's purposes in keeping society functioning and making the place where you live a little bit more tolerable of a place to live. Church, God has never encouraged anarchy, but no matter what form of government a nation may have, God expects governments to restrain what is evil. A second reason God instituted governments is to punish wrongdoers. This takes things a little further, doesn't it? Paul says, but if you do wrong, be afraid, because he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Church, it always grieved me. Some of you don't know, I used to practice law in Connecticut, and it always grieved me, first as a lawyer and now, of course, also as a pastor, to watch people being sentenced to prison and seeing them being taken away. It's painful to see, and it's something that's very sobering. And I'm sure that no judge enjoys doing it, but it's necessary in order to maintain society. And Paul is asserting here the sad truth that this is one of the reasons why God instituted governments. He says that rulers are agents of his wrath so that society can be protected. He says that secular authorities have the sword. That was a symbol in Paul's day of the right to rule and to keep civil disorders in check and maybe even take human life if necessary in order to protect society as a whole. Church, that's a sad commentary, isn't it, on the condition of the human race while we wait for Jesus' coming? The third reason God instituted governments, Paul says, is to promote what is good. He says, do what is good and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. So not only do governments fight evil, God intends for governments to promote what is good. Did you know that in the ancient world, in the Roman world that Paul was familiar with, governments praised and even rewarded citizens for working for the common good? If you did something great that benefited your city, the government might actually give you money as a reward, or they might put up a statue in your honor or something like that. It was something that was done as a way to promote people working for the betterment of society. And obviously, governments still do this today. Governments still promote morality and the public welfare through legislation and education and all kinds of initiatives, as we know. No government has ever been perfect, but this is what good government is designed to do. Paul says governments should approve of things and approve of people who are good. Our own U.S. Constitution has in its preamble those words telling us that it was designed to establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty. Every form of government should be promoting those things because they're good things. So, church, I want you to understand here that God's word does not even see government as a necessary evil, let's say, but as something that he can use for the betterment of the human race. So government's not only a good thing, it's not only a God thing, it's also a good thing, as God uses government to influence the human race by punishing evil and promoting what is good. One more truth about government from Romans 13, and it's this. Government is a gospel thing. Government is a gospel thing. In verses 4 and 5, Paul calls rulers the servant of God. And he says, therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. Government is a gospel thing. We're saying that it's God's authority extended in the world, and it can also be viewed as a conduit for God's influence over people in the world. But we also see that part of God's design for government is to have God's people shining as lights in the world. Did you know that good government can serve the cause of Christ? Now, this happens in several ways, and we need to dig into this because this is where the rubber meets the road for us. Thinking about government, what is my responsibility as a believer in Christ? Well, first, we see that we need to behave well for conscience' sake, Paul says. He says that we must be in subjection to rulers, not only to avoid wrath, in other words, not just because we're afraid to be punished, but for the sake of conscience. We should have a sincere desire to do what is right. As Christian people, we ought to submit to rulers for the right reasons, Paul is saying. Do you know that the Bible tells us it's important for us to be able to disprove the world's mistaken ideas about us by our transformed lifestyle. In Peter's first letter, Peter echoes what Paul is saying here very closely. Listen, I want you to hear these words from 1 Peter 2. He says, "Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it's to the emperor as supreme or to governors, being those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers, and for the praise of those who do good." Listen, "For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men." You know that in the Roman world, there were all kinds of weird and slanderous and crazy accusations that were thrown at believers. And isn't that still the case today all around the world? We know, don't we, that believers will always be under the watchful gaze of a curious world. They are looking to see if our preaching of a Christ who can transform them is backed up by any evidence in our lives. Do we really look like new people? Do we really walk like new people? So, church, how people perceive us and how we walk towards government, Paul and Peter are telling us here, will reveal the truth about us and about the gospel that we are carrying. We also owe the government, Paul says, honor and respect. In verse 7, Paul says, "We owe respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed." You know, as Christians, we stand in a unique position in the world. Why? Because the word teaches us that we are citizens of heaven. God has already, he says, seated us in Christ, with Christ in heavenly places. So Philippians 3:20 says, "Our citizenship is in heaven, and from heaven we are awaiting a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." But church, I want you to know that our citizenship, according to what Paul's saying here, is not exclusively in heaven. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world." But do you know that for the time being, God's children, seemingly, we have dual citizenship. For the sake of conscience, we follow the laws of the earthly government where we find ourselves, wherever we are. Jesus said, "Go ahead and pay that tax, lest we give them offense." We honor and we respect human leaders. You know, God was quite serious about this. He commanded his people not even to revile their rulers, meaning not to speak abusively about them or curse them. You can read about Paul being in front of the Sanhedrin in the book of Acts, and he was challenged by them because he had spoken sharply to the high priest in an abusive type of a way. And he said, "Brothers, I didn't know that it was the high priest." So Paul's saying, "If I had known it was the high priest, I wouldn't have spoken about him in that fashion." Daniel and his friends, they treated the pagan king of Babylon with respect, even when they were being tossed to lions or tossed into a furnace. And they addressed the king by saying, "O king, live forever." And if it was me, I probably would have said, "O king, live not so very much longer," right? But church, this is a word we need to hear, because we live in a day when Christian people often find it easier and more satisfying to pray upon leaders than to pray for leaders. And if you can't say amen, say oh my right there. So again, we honor all those in authority, not because they are the best and godliest of men, but because of the position that God has seen fit to give them. Another thing that we owe government, Paul says, is the payment of taxes. So I guess I'm going from the frying pan into the fire now, right? Did you hear Pastor Glenn last week saying that he gives Pastor Nick all the hard messages? All right. But Paul says, "We give taxes to whom they are due." And the words that he uses here actually are very specific words. He actually mentions there two different types of Roman taxes. One was the tax that was on people's heads and on their property, and the other was the kind of tax that was like customs or business taxes and things like that. So Paul is very specific with them. The Holy Spirit says that because rulers are full-time engaged in caring for society that they are entitled to receive taxes for their support. But nowhere in Scripture does God ever give us permission to withhold taxes for any reason because we disagree with something that the government is doing. Jesus himself said, "Render to Caesar that which belongs to Caesar." And friends, can I tell you this morning that Jesus said that of a government that was far worse than anything that an American president is or has come up with. Paul says rulers are ministers of God who are always serving us, and so we need to render them their due. All right, another very important thing we owe as Christians to government, we owe our submission to rulers, listen, if not always our complete obedience. We owe government our submission, but not necessarily our complete obedience. Paul said at the beginning of chapter 13, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities." But this does not mean that we give total and unconditional obedience to man. That is not the teaching of God's word. As Christians, we need to understand that submission is a matter of the heart. It's the attitude of respect that we have for authorities at all times. So submission is unconditional, but obedience is conditional. We must always walk before rulers in a Christ-like way, but church, hear me, it is only God who is entitled to our complete allegiance and our complete obedience. When governments who are supposed to be ruling as the ministers of God come to actually oppose God, the Christian must sometimes engage in civil disobedience. And that disobedience, if you'll pardon the pun, must be civil. Pastor and author John Stott explained it like this. Whenever laws are enacted which contradict God's law, civil disobedience becomes a Christian duty. When Pharaoh ordered the Hebrew midwives to kill the newborn boys, they refused to obey. The midwives feared God and did not do what the king of Egypt had told them to do. They let the boys live. And you know, the Bible says that God blessed them for that. When King Nebuchadnezzar issued an edict that all his subjects must fall down and worship his golden image, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to obey. When King Darius made a decree that for 30 days nobody should pray to any god or man except himself, Daniel refused to obey. And when the Sanhedrin banned preaching in the name of Jesus, the apostles refused to obey. All these were heroic refusals in spite of the threats which accompanied the edicts. In each case, civil disobedience involved great personal risk, including possible loss of life. In each case, its purpose was to demonstrate their submissiveness to God and not their defiance of government. So, church, while Christians cannot give complete obedience to the state, we should always be submissive in our hearts, like those saints of old who said, "O King, live forever." And I should also note again that those saints were willing to accept the consequences of persecution. Now, our situation is unique, isn't it? Because of the form of government that we do enjoy. How many of you know we are blessed to live in a society where we enjoy freedoms that were truly unknown for most of history? And where we do possess rights as Christians or as citizens, where we can legally defend ourselves against harsh government action, we should do so. And again, the Apostle Paul is our good example here. Paul was a Roman citizen. And Paul used his rights of citizenship to advance his gospel mission. He did not tamely surrender his rights, but when he had rights as a Roman citizen that he could use, he used them in order to be treated better so that the gospel could reach a wider audience. That's a painting of Paul preaching in front of King Agrippa. And so Paul's Roman right of appeal, which he possessed because he was a Roman, that right of appeal took him all the way to King Agrippa's court and ultimately all the way to the court of Emperor Nero, where he made his defense and proclaimed Christ twice. You and I can also use the rights that we possess to good advantage. As American believers, we can engage in the political process at any level. What a shame if Christians don't act as salt and light by being involved in government. What a shame if, while we have such freedoms, we don't even vote and at least make our voices known. You know that millions around the world, of course, have no voice, and yet too often we fail to take advantage of ours. We know, don't we, that in a very real sense, in our system, we ourselves are the rulers. But do we avail ourselves of our freedoms? This self-rulership, I believe, is a wonderful privilege from God, but it also comes with a tremendous responsibility. One more responsibility that we have towards government, one more way that we interact with it, and it's this. We have the duty of intercession for our leaders. We have the duty of intercession for our leaders. Worship team, you can come back, please, and help us. Paul calls rulers the ministers of God. And I don't know if you've ever thought about it this way, but like any minister of God, their good work is opposed by evil supernatural forces. Good government, leadership that would promote what is good and restrains evil, that kind of government is opposed by the enemy of our souls. Bad government, government that would hinder the spread of the gospel and that would work against God's people, that kind of government is described very harshly in Scripture. How many of you know that the Bible portrays persecuting governments as beasts, as wild animals that destroy the flock of God? It portrays them as being motivated by and animated by the power of Satan. And so for the sake of the gospel, as well as for the sake of our societies, God's people have the duty to work and the duty to pray. Imagine this. As God's people were being taken away from Israel into Babylon, into captivity, you can read in Jeremiah 29 that God told his people, listen, seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it, for in its peace, you will have peace. Can you imagine that? And can we who are here, so blessed in America, enjoying both Christian liberty and political liberty, can we do any less than to pray for our nation? In 1 Timothy 2, Paul shows the church the attitude we should adopt. He says, I exhort that first of all, supplications and prayers and intercession and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, so that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Listen, who desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. That's an amazing passage of Scripture, church. When Paul wrote Romans, Nero was actually a rather mild character compared to what he would become. But by the time Paul wrote those words in 1 Timothy, Nero had already blamed the Christians for the great fire in Rome. And he was persecuting Christians horribly, slaughtering Christians in unspeakable ways that I won't detail for you this morning. And church, it's in the context of that older, much more vicious emperor, Nero, that Paul says, first of all, you must even make supplications. And if you don't know what that is, that supplication is the kind of forceful, emotional kind of prayer that comes even with tears. You must make even that kind of praying for the wicked emperor and for all who are in authority. Imagine that. And he says, we need to do that so that we can live a quiet and peaceable life. And the result of that peaceable life, Paul says, will be the spread of the gospel. Paul implies that we need these peaceful conditions because God wants people to be saved. How many of you know that if there's chaos in your city, if there's turmoil in your city, if there's crime that's out of control in your city, then the gospel message can't spread as easily as God would like it to spread. Society will find it harder to receive the word of God. It'll be harder for you to work in society when there's chaos. Now, let's not pretend that America is in that kind of condition. None of our recent presidents have been any Nero. But church, how many of you know that our nation needs prayer? Our leaders do too, on every level of government. We need good government. We need government that has integrity. King David said, "He who rules over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God." I find from the word of God that governments need the saints to come alongside them and give them a living word from heaven. And if we pray, God will do it. How many of you know that Joseph brought the word of the Lord to Pharaoh, and all that did was save the world? Jonah brought a word of repentance that caused the whole wicked city of Nineveh to humble herself, from the king on his throne all the way down to the cattle in the field. Daniel brought the light of heaven into the darkness of Babylonian palaces that were being managed by masters of the occult. And Esther was raised up. She was brought to the Persian kingdom to be the answer for her day. In those famous words, you know, "For such a time as this." And so it is for us, church, especially for those of us who are young. Listen, of all the seasons in history, God has caused you to be alive in these days. You are here by His amazing grace. And with some of us, let's be honest, God has rescued us, some of us, in such a way that we're just here by the skin of our teeth. Amen. And who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Government was God's idea, but He still needs some Daniels and He needs some Esthers to be salt and light so that government will serve God's purposes, not only to make a better society, but to make it possible for God's word to continue to spread and bring souls into His kingdom. Government is a God thing. It was His idea. Government is a good thing. He arranges governments to serve godly purposes. And government is a gospel thing. If you and I will demonstrate the light of Christ and pray, praying earnestly for our nation and for our state and for our city and for their leaders, God will position us to impact our cities with fresh life from heaven. May His kingdom come and may His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Come on, would you stand together with me? Let's give Jesus a praise in His house. Hallelujah.